Welcome to St. George's online community. Kia ora koutou. Today we will continue our journey exploring and celebrating the rich treasure and heritage of our worship songs. It's been really great to have so many lovely comments and messages coming through to us to say how much you're enjoying this current series. So keep spreading the word and please feel free to share our link on YouTube from YouTube and to family and friends. We'd love to share the good news. This series has been based on those wonderful words of St. Paul in Colossians 3 verse 16. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And today our theme is spiritual songs to God, as Josh will be celebrating two songs that have become part of the spiritual DNA of culture. Josh will ask, what is it about these songs that give them the power to continue down the centuries, touching and transforming lives? Today is also the last day of Te Reo Māori Language Week, so it feels appropriate to mention that the word waiata, of course, is te reo for song. But for Māori, this is about much more than just a song. A waiata is core to Māori way of life, marking important life events such as the birth of a child, mourning in times of loss, and falling in love. In other words, the waiata is an expression of life. And this, of course, is what the Psalms were for the Hebrew people. So these spiritual songs that God to God, that are our worship song heritage, are more than just songs. They are part of our spiritual whakapapa. So we're really looking forward to another rich journey of worship together. So let's take a moment to pause for reflection. Bring before God all that we have and all that we are. Let us pray these words based on the words of St. Paul. With the wisdom that Christ gives, let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. Let the gift of these hymns and spiritual songs speak fresh encouragement and insight into our hearts and lives. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, cultivate in us thankful hearts so that whatever we say and do, we do it as a representative of the Christ Jesus. So let's continue our journey of worship together, singing this beautiful song.
Oh, Our reading today is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, verses 26 to 30. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it, for this is my body." Then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, "Each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Mark my words, I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Then they sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Well, kia ora koutou everybody, and it's great to be with you today. I have to say, I'm very excited to be celebrating these two beautiful waiata, himene, that are so much part of our worship heritage. But I want to begin by just taking you back a few seconds to those words that Judy gave us from Matthew's Gospel. Did you notice what's just taken place? Well, firstly, Jesus and his disciples have just finished the most remembered meal in human history, the Last Supper. Now they are about to go to the Mount of Olives and the Garden of Gethsemane. And as we know, for Jesus, this will be his most anguished night on earth, as he knows he's about to face the full horror of his own execution. So what is it that Jesus and his disciples took the time to do in between these two momentous moments for Jesus? Well, this is what we read in verse 30. They sang a hymn and then went out to the Mount of Olives. I wonder how often have you, when you've read the Gospels, pictured Jesus actually singing a song? I confess, I haven't done this too often. But clearly for Jesus and his friends, taking the time to sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God was actually core to who they are. And I guess for me, hearing one sentence is the real power of these spiritual songs to God. Because worshipping communities down the centuries and across the globe have done exactly what Jesus and his disciples took the time to do. Why? Well, because these songs, they give voice to the full range of our human condition, our deep sorrows and our seekings, our hopes and our yearnings, and our thanksgiving and our praise. They are not just songs. They are actually part of our spiritual whakapapa. So today, through two particular hymns, I want to celebrate the way certain songs have become part of the spiritual DNA of culture. And I want to ask, what is it about these songs that gives them the power to reverberate down the centuries, still able to touch and transform lives? And I want to start with my own personal experience of their power. Now, as many of you know, I came to faith via a convoluted seeking and searching sort of route, really, that kind of culminated in coming to Alpha. And as I look back on this journey, I can actually recognise one pivotal moment on a Sunday in good old Acock Green, Birmingham, almost 23 years ago. You see, every Sunday for many years, the Jones clan, our whānau, would all gather at my mum and dad's house. Now, we were a large clan, are the Joneses, so my two brothers and their families and my family and mum and dad would all get together to have Sunday lunch, to play games, and just generally hang out together. We're a very close family. In the evening, as we were all winding down and pretty exhausted from the kids, at 6:30, the religious program, Songs of Praise, would come on. Now, it has to be said that no one in the Joneses was very religious, including me at this time. So this was usually the cue for someone to kind of groan, boring, and go to change the channels. But one Sunday, no one got to the remote quick enough, and I suddenly caught the strains of a beautiful hymn that I recognized. And just as one of my brothers was about to change the channel, I remember shouting, "Hold on a second, leave it. I just want to hear this song." And I can still see the perplexed look on my brother's face, thinking I'd kind of lost it a little. But as I listened to this beautiful spiritual song to God, I could feel something inside me stirring, something long forgotten. This song was clearly more part of my spiritual DNA than I realized. And I'm going to show you a visual demonstration, a video, of one of the core reasons why this would be. You see, for most of my lifetime in England, one of the biggest sporting occasions was the soccer FA Cup final. And in 1927, a tradition began to sing this hymn before the game. A year later, in 1928, the Rugby League Cup final, which I also used to watch, did exactly the same thing with exactly the same song. To this day, this classic hymn is still sung at both matches every year. So what you're about to see is sort of an annual moment of God breaking into culture. The power of the spiritual song to weave its way into our spiritual DNA. What is this song? We'll take a look. Used to move me every time, even when I was a child, and it still does touch me in very deep ways, this beautiful waiata. So what is it about this particular song that speaks to the human spirit and gives it the power to transcend? Because this was actually a favourite of Mahatma Gandhi and the poet Alfred Tennyson. It was played by the band on the Titanic as many people went to their death. It was played in the opening celebration of the 2012 Olympic Games in London. And it's been recorded by people from Doris Day to Paul McCartney. Well, firstly, I would say it's got that perfect marriage of melody and words that every song that wants to endure has to have. But secondly, and have you noticed this is a bit of a recurring theme in this series, that these deeply profound songs are so often inspired by profound experiences of the composer themselves. And it's the story of this song too. In 1847, Henry Light, an English priest, was just a few weeks away from death by tuberculosis. And as so often happens in life, when we travel into the deepest places of our human experience, we often come back carrying beautiful treasure. Savour these magnificent words. Swift to its close, ebbs out life's little day. Earth's joys grow dim, its glories pass away. Change and decay in all around I see. O thou who changest not, abide with me. So what's the power of these poetic words? Well, for me, it's because they speak about more than just the end of our lives and the approaching death. They actually speak into the transitory nature of life itself, because every day of every week, month and year, we experience change and decay. All our glories will eventually pass away. It's the bitter and the sweet of life, the achingly beautiful. But at the foundation of our faith, of course, is that we have a sure and certain hope, to quote Hebrews, that in Father, Son, and Spirit, we abide in the presence of the eternal God. Abide in me, promised Jesus, and I will abide in you. And remember, I will always be with you until the end of the age, said Jesus. And clearly Robert Light, the composer, in his own deep place, had glimpsed this sure and certain hope. Listen to these words. I fear no foe, with thee at hand to bless. Ills have no weight, and tears no bitterness. Where is death's sting? Where grave thy victory? I triumph still, if thou abide with me. You know, in what feels like an increasingly troubled and wounded world, these words for me are like a balm, healing ointment for our tormented, injured souls. So what is your place of heaviness and burden at this time? What are your tears or your fears? Whatever they may be, let this spiritual song from God remind you of the ever-present eternal God, who always abides and is always at hand to heal and to bless you. Which brings me to one more song that had the same power to enter the spiritual psyche of culture, and again was actually key to my own journey to faith. Back in 1970, a world-renowned pop star had his world shattered by a serious illness, strangely enough, tuberculosis. And he had to have a lung removed. But while in convalescence, he rediscovered a beautiful old hymn. And when he regained his health, he recorded it and he released it. And just like the song Amazing Grace, it became a worldwide hit. It topped the American charts, entered the top 10 in the UK, and actually got to number 3 in good old Aotearoa, New Zealand. What was this spiritual song to God? It was this.
Morning has broken like the first morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world.
The keyboard player on that song, that beautiful refrain, is Rick Wakeman from the band Yes. And in a documentary, Wakeman said that he felt that Cat Stevens' version of Morning Has Broken had brought people closer to religious truth. And I can personally testify to the truth of this statement by Rick Wakeman. I loved this song when it came out in 1972 when I was but just a lad. But almost 30 years later, as I explored and journeyed Alpha, this was one of the key songs that was part of my spiritual awakening. So what's the global appeal of this particular song? Well, again, a beautiful melody. But what about the lyrics? How are they speaking to the listener? Because at a glance, these words can seem very simple. But look a little bit deeper. And what these words are reminding us is to see the gift of each new day through the eyes of awe and wonder. Because the gift of each new morning sits in the miracle of the vast eternal. Now, I personally consider the opening line of this spiritual song to be one of the most profound of all the songs to God. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light that the Garden of Eden saw play. The gift of the new day and the miracle of the vast eternal. So when you wake up tomorrow and you greet the new morning and you're just trying to cultivate an attitude of gratitude, just take a moment to pause and ponder that the gift of this new morning is exactly like the breaking in of the very first morning of all creation. And when you hear the birds singing, this is an echo of the very first bird song to ever light up the tapestry of creation. What's the only response possible to such an awe-inspiring thought? Well, the third verse tells us. Give praise with elation. Give praise every morning, because this is God's recreation of the new day. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I want to finish with these final thoughts. Two songs, two wayata of sublime beauty, both with the power to transcend and endure, both taking us closer to the domain of the divine and the speech of angels, both of them in their own way reminding us that each day is a gift, a sacred gift, that we must seize, cherish and savour. So I want to respond to all of this with one of my own songs, the first worship song I ever wrote, because I too had a personal experience of the God who transforms, who is all in all, and I wanted to celebrate it with a spiritual song to God.
Lord, giver of this day, giver of this life, to you we sing. Christ, ever in our hearts, ever in our souls, inspiring. God of the weak and poor and lonely, God of the seeking soul, God of the broken, scared and troubled, the God who can make us whole. Lord, giver of this day, giver of this life, to you we sing. Christ, ever this life to you we send. Christ, ever in our hearts, ever in our souls, inspiring. God on the cross and the sun revealing that love is the way to peace. God is the balm to heal divisions, the giver of love's relief. Sacred diversity, God of all children, color and races, the God of humanity, the God of humanity. Lord, giver of this day, giver of this life, to you we sing. Christ, ever in our hearts, ever in our souls, inspiring.
Good morning.
Kia ora koutou, I am here in our family prayer den to lead us all this morning in prayers. First the Lord's Prayer and then the grace in Te Reo Māori. So kia inoi tātou. E tō mātou mātou e te rangi, kia tapu tō inoa, kia tai mai tō ranga teretanga, kia me tia tau e pai ai ki runga ki te whenua. Kia rite anō ki tō te rangi, hō mai kia mātou ai nei he taruma mātou mō tēnei rā. Muru o mātou hara, me mātou hoki e muru nei o te honge harana kia mātou. Aua hoki mātou e kauia kia whakawaia, engari whakarongi o mātou e te kino, nō hoki te rangatiratanga, te kaha, me te kororia. Ake, hake, ake. Āmini. And the grace. Kia tau, kia tātou katoa. Te atawhai o tō tātou ariki a ihu karaiti. Me te aroha o te atua. Me te whiwhinga tahitanga ki te wairua tapu. Ake, ake, ake. Āmini. Kia ora whānau.
Well, thank you for joining us once again, everyone. It's been a privilege to share this worship journey together. There are two suggested takeaways from Josh for us to think about over the week to come and today. Firstly, over lunch today, perhaps have a discussion on why you think certain songs have this power to enter into the spiritual DNA of culture and continue to touch and transform lives. And secondly, maybe spend some time quietly reflecting on the beautiful spiritual songs Abide With Me and Morning Has Broken. You could use the profound lyrics as part of your reflection time and think about which lyrics resonate most deeply for you and why. There's also a stunning contemporary version of the song Abide With Me, so we're going to send the link out for you with the full version. Please don't forget to click the subscribe button and use the comment section on YouTube, as it all helps to spread the word. Thank you. So go now to love and serve the Lord. Go in peace. Amen. We go in the name of Christ.